to another episode of Writings from the Hills. And today we are going to actually be discussing or reading a selection from Bluegrass and Rhododendron by John Fox, Jr. And we'd like to thank the University Press of Kentucky for allowing us to use this book for our program. First, I'm going to read the first chapter, The Southern Mountaineer. It was only a little while ago that the materialists declared that humanity was the product of heredity and environment, that history lies not near but in nature, and that in consequence man must take his head from the clouds and steady himself with his feet where they belong, to the earth. Since then, the mountains have taken on a new importance for the part they played in the destiny of a race. For the reason that the mountains has dammed the streams of humanity, and have let them settle in the valleys and spread out over the plains, or have sent them along detours around. When some of the unusual pressures have forced a current through the mountain pass, the hills have cut it off from the main stream, and have held it so stagnant that to change the figure, the mountains may be said to have kept the records of human history, somewhat as fossils hold the history of the earth. Arcadia held primitive inhabitants of Greece, who fled to its rough hills after the Dorian invasion. The Pyrenees kept unconquered, strikingly unchanged, the Basque, sole remnants perhaps in Western Europe of the Aborigines, who were swept away by the tides of the Aryan immigration. Just as the Rocky Mountains protect the American Indian in the primitive barbarianism, and not wholly subdued today, the Cumberland Range keeps the Southern Mountaineer to the backward civilization of a revolution. The reason is plain. The mountain dweller lives apart from the world. The present is the past when it reaches him, and the past is yet too far in the future to have any bearing on his established order of things. There is, in consequence, no incentive whatsoever for him to change. An arrest of development follows, so that once imprisoned, a civilization with its dress, speech, religion, custom, ideas, may be caught like the shapes of a lower life in stone, and may tell the human story of a century as the rocks tell the story of an age. For centuries, the Highlander has had plaid and kilt. The peasantry of Norway and the mountaineer of German and Austrian Alps each a habit of his own, and every Swiss canton a distinct dress. The mountains preserve the Gaelic tone, in which the scholar may yet read the refuge of the Celt from Saxon, and in turn the Saxon from the Norman French, just as they keep alive remnants like the Rhodo-Roman, the Basque, and the number of Caucasian dialects. The Carpathians protect Christianity against the Moors, and in Java the Brahmin faith took refuge on the sides of the volcanic Gunung Lawa. And where outlived the ban of Buddha. So in the long cabinet of the Southern Mountaineer, in his household furnishing, in his homespun, his linsey, and occasionally in his hunting shirt, his coonskin cap and moccasins, one may summon up the garb and the life of a pioneer. In his religion, his politics, his moral code, his folk songs, and his superstitions, one may bridge the waters back to the old country, and through his speech, one may even touch the remote past of Chaucer. For today, he is a distinct remnant of colonial times, a distinct relic of the Anglo-Saxon past. It is odd to think that he was not discovered until the outbreak of the Civil War. Although he was nearly a century old then, it is really startling to realize that when one speaks of the Southern Mountaineers, he speaks of nearly 3 million of people who lived in the 8 southern states, Virginia and Alabama, and the southern states between, and occupied a region equal in area to the combined areas of Ohio and Pennsylvania, as big, say, as the German Empire, and richer, perhaps, in timber and mineral deposits than any other region in a similar extent in the world. This region was and is unknown land, and is aptly called Appalachian America. And the work of the discovery is yet going on. If
you would like to read more of Bluegrass and the Rhododendron by John Fox, Jr., you can check it out by going to our website at www.briggslibrary.com. And again, a special thanks to University Press of Kentucky for allowing us to use this book. Thank you.